Questions? Comments?
Is everybody blushing?
Awesome. Okay, we're good. We're done. Thanks. Something more elaborate, perhaps. Yeah, right over there.
First off, I want to say congratulations on such a stunning piece. I'm thrilled to see Toronto as the backdrop for such a story as well. What was it like to make history as one of Canada's pioneering 100% female cast and crew?
What was it like to make history as a pioneering as the first 100% female cast and crew in Canada? Or crew, sorry.
There's some guys in there.
Oh, pardon me, sorry, crew. Of course.
Crew with the token guys, yeah.
Personally, I think it's about time, and this couldn't have been a better suited film to do that, because we were really aiming with one specific goal: to create a female's perspective of what it's like to fall in love and lust and what turns us on. And predominantly what we've been exposed to is through TV and advertising and film is through a male's perspective. So that goal, having that goal of the female lens, was an exciting one, and to have all of the keys involved in, you know, every aspect of the film to be truly female just strengthened the film, and the results are on the screen.
You guys want to add difference in terms of difference, or like as a shooting experience?
Yeah.
Do
you want to talk about that?
No, go ahead. I think one of the things that I observed while we were shooting this film, which was an amazing thing, was just the kind of very calm, peaceful vibe on set. The women, you know, our group were just, they're really smart, obviously amazing people, but they just respected each other in a very amazing way. It was like the way that we communicated with each other, and it was very sort of subtle, and it was a really quiet set, a really nice, respectful, quiet set. And some of the crew are here tonight, and they were incredible, so
thank you.
You guys want to talk about what it was like for your performance, how about it?
Sure. I think both Erica and I felt, having all the women, the whole crew being women, that it just provided a safe bubble. We didn't feel like we were being looked at any different. It kind of just felt like we were in a women's change room all the time. Yeah, and I think, you know, everyone on the crew felt like they were part of something special, and everyone was invested in telling the story.
Next. It is actually literally impossible to see anything here. Yeah. Okay, go for it. Did the best friend of Desiree ever hook up?
Yes. Hell yeah.
I don't think so. I think that Desiree, I think it's only that one. That's what she needs to do. After a message, she wants to know. Desiree wants to know.
Makes sense.
That's a good question.
Next, just wave your lights. Or scenario, right?
I just wanted to commend the cast, and I was just listening to you, what you were saying about all the wall, that female cast and crew, and how that, how...
And the roofers.
But it just really came across the ease, and the performances were so vulnerable and connected. It was really lovely to watch.
I gentlemen complimented you guys in the atmosphere, presumably the atmosphere on the set, the community, it obviously was evident on the frame in terms of the comfort and ease and the performances and the mood. So.
And Eric and I have something in common. We've both done scenes with Andrea Stefanchikova.
Oh! Oh, Eric and you guys
That's great.
Similar,
yeah.
To that.
She's
a dancer.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
Great.
Next. Anything, yeah, right in the middle there. Good question. The choice of music seems quite deliberate. What was the process of that? How did you guys select the music?
The process for that, we had some fantastic composers on the film. Noya, who did a lot of all the score, all the original score, and then actually the music on the film, April, Stephanie, and myself, we did it together. And some of the songs were, Stephanie was inspired by some of the songs when she was writing the script. Certainly the song Keep Me High that plays by Adeline, beautiful musician that plays when they're on their date and they kiss into the laneway. We wanted the music to be very bold. We wanted to use a lot of Canadian artists, which we did, a lot of independent Canadian artists, and I don't know, we just did a lot of digging, like these two especially did like a ton of digging and just down. And by the way, if you wanted to be bold, did I say that? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just that for us, the music, we wanted it to have a personality as well, so that basically the love scenes, although they felt very untouched and raw and honest, like you were saying, and polished, as an overall experience, the journey of the film, we wanted to feel very cinematic, so to draw you in and take you somewhere. And the music allowed us to do that as well.
Next. Just shout it out, really. Well, you've already asked one, and that's, right over there.
Hi, thank you for this piece. It was beautiful. Very beautiful, and took me back from talking to my straight-minded self, to my lovely wife here. So, how did your, I'm just wondering, for the two actors, how did you, I expect it took a number of days or weeks or whatever, how did you get into relating to each other so sexually every day and deal through and your personal self? Because it was so intimate. How did you get into that?
The lady said it took her back to when she met her wife. Cool. And she wanted to know how you guys got into that sort of very intimate headspace, and you know, that if you could talk a bit about how that developed.
I think we have our team to really thank, because they created a really, we were in a bubble. We really were. We were very secluded. We were both put up in a hotel, and we had the opportunity to really just be those characters day in and day out. And I think, we spent a couple weeks beforehand going through the script with the producers and all of us. We went through the script in great detail and talked about all the intimate scenes in a lot of detail, because we really wanted to get the nuance of it all right. But
I think also in the chemistry, we felt it pretty instantly too, that it was going to work out and that we could build something together. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, hi. Oh, thank you. How's it going? Amazing. I feel like Natalie and Erica, when we were casting and auditioning them, right away they had a lot of kind of chemistry, and they would seem to really respect each other a lot, and they really, really took care of each other. So in some of the scenes, like for instance the rain scene, it was freezing cold. It was literally the coldest night that we were shooting, and the rain was cold, so dropping on them. And they were just so cute, the way they did it twice. We went through it twice, so just the way they sort of supported each other and cared for each other. So I feel like the way that they respected one another and cared for each other and supported each other really came through on the screen. And certainly, obviously, April spent a lot of time with them, and we really did keep them in a bubble, kept them together on set a lot, very private. It was a closed set, so they had a lot of time with each other, and they just really respected each other's process and really encouraged each other. And I think you feel that between them on the screen, certainly. So,
an interesting fun fact, we shot almost chronologically, which isn't normal for a feature film. Usually you tend to gravitate towards what makes the most sense with a budget. But we tried really hard to keep their journey in real time, which I feel made a big difference on the final. Like the last scene with you and Ron in the bathtub, and you two in the bathtub, was the last day of shooting. So there were so many emotions running through their bodies and knowing that we were nearing an end. And also in terms of takes, we never really went past one or two takes because it was so important for all of us to keep it fresh and make sure that they were never, you know, hitting marks or trying to, aim to something that we were trying to create. We really wanted to have the screen feel alive. And for that to happen, it was like take one and two, and if there's imperfections and out of focus and maybe somebody isn't perfectly in light, it doesn't matter. What matters is the emotional connection between the two of them and that it transpires on the screen.
Oh, it's so cool you shot chronologically, that's awesome. No one does that. It's very neat. Right there.
Just a quick question on the casting. How did you find your cast?
Question about the casting. How did you guys cast the film?
I'll talk about Natalie. So Stephanie and I have gone to a play called Crimes of the Heart. Is that what it's called, Natalie? Crimes of the Heart. It's an excellent play at a really tiny playhouse. And Natalie was the star of the play, and she blew us away. That's really what happened. We've been seeing actors, we've been seeing some really great people, but we really needed to feel Jasmine. And we weren't there casting. We were actually taking a break that night, going on a date. And of course, I interrupted. I was like, we're not working tonight. And at the end, I said, okay, let's talk about her. She can be our Jasmine. Suddenly, we're working. And she came in and read for us. It was the second round of auditions at that point. And for us, I think it was never anybody else at that point. So, and then April found Erica.
It was just literally, I never do this, but I was Googling fresh faces because Stephanie had portrayed, Stephanie portrayed this incredible, charismatic, like, can change your life in an instant character, Dallas. This like bravado that just jumped off the page, and I was like, if we don't have that, we don't have a film. And then there's this little black and white video where Erica didn't speak, but she was in black and white, like looking so amazing and like, you know, a model. And at the end, she's like, I don't know my lines. And she said it with an accent, but we weren't sure if she spoke English or not. And then the hunt was on, and we called over to Switzerland. And then you did speak English. And then we all met her as a team. We all flew down to Los Angeles and met her, and instantly were drawn to her unique characteristics. And then when they read together, like we mentioned, the chemistry was unreal.
So that's a tip for any actors. Don't do any lines, just black and white photographs. Go ahead. Did you, the gentleman said the film was quite provocative. Did you have any issues with, like, what you were going to include? It hasn't been through the censor board yet or anything like that.
Well, the production company that was involved, Serendipity Point Films, were just so supportive and encouraging. They picked up the material and loved the script. And then
my producers, Serendipity Point Films, and Robert Lantos, most called them, they never stopped me from being who I wanted to be on the page, and I'm about to be as brave and provocative as I wanted to be. And I thank you both for that, actually.
Thank you. We had, because when we made the film, it's very much an independent process. We made it before we attracted, we made it ourselves before bringing on a distributor. So, and we knew what we wanted to do. Stephanie and I originated the project. We started working on it together. We, when I pitched it to Serendipity, it was like, this is what we want to do. This is our vision. This is, we felt that there was an underrepresentation of queer characters and fully realized roles. And we really wanted to focus on a love story between two women that didn't dwell on the fact that it was two women and make it a big scene. We just really wanted to focus on the connection and the love, and we wanted to be very bold, and we wanted to push the boundaries, and we wanted to show the intimacy from a place that we felt was authentic. So So, you know, when Stephanie wrote the script, she very much was very, very clear. She scripted out all the intimate scenes so that we knew what we were delivering and that everybody knew what they were participating in. That was just really important to us. And we, as Stephanie said, we were supported all the way. We were just given freedom to do whatever we wanted. And, yeah, kind of a dream situation. And it's scary because it's a bold film. So then you take it out and you show it to other people. And yeah, we've been lucky. We've never had a conversation so far where anybody said, oh, would you scale back on this or would you recut that? Or and we won't. So thankfully, no one's asked.
Is there anybody at the back? Because I can't just shout it out if you're at the back.
There.
Anyone? Okay, go ahead.
Not bad. Not too
how
bad.
How many takes did it take to do the Fillmore Hotel show?
I'm neurotic with choreography and organization. So we ran the inside while we were setting up the crane outside because we were on a very tight 19-day schedule. We ran the choreography with the dancers and all the waitresses and the extras and Erica indoors, you know, for 45 minutes while they set the crane up outside. And then we had our apps ready because I really wanted to showcase the streetcars of Toronto. And I wanted two of them because they crossed.
Yeah,
and then this is like when my nerd comes out.
Woo!
Yeah,
great shot.
Exactly. And then we also choreographed some of our transport to help us with lights because I really wanted some backlight and some bounce from the street. And we did the very top movement twice because we missed the streetcar once. And then once we hit it twice, we went inside, and so it's only total three. Yeah. We wanted it to be done before sunrise. It's true, we did get it on the first take, but it wasn't the two streetcars.
But the sun was coming up.
The sun was coming up, and we were running out of time. And so April, literally, it was choreographed like you couldn't believe. The crane drops, boom, everybody's pushing forward.
We were all shuffling behind the camera like this.
You know, here comes one streetcar, here comes the other. We nailed that. We get inside, down the stairs, and then the whole place comes alive. So,
oh, yeah. And our first AD fell down the stairs, but we kept going. Phil, I love you. Sorry that that happened.
She fell down the stairs. It was really painful.
Because
but
we only had very little time.
We had one chance. Yeah, I had to be.
But she was okay.
Yeah, she was okay.
Phil was good.
Yeah, it made it exciting. It was all like very tantalizing.
Okay, we can do one more question. Sorry, do you guys want
to
ask?
She wants
two more.
We don't want it to end.
Okay.
Go ahead.
If this is quick, we might be able to do two. Go.
Well, that's a lot of fun. So I wanted to say first to the two actresses, I mean, you both were incredibly brave. So I just want to say that I've hats off, because that's a tremendous feat.
They said you guys are really brave.
Yeah.
Eric and Natalie. Cool.
I was curious to know, for you guys, if there was any Merkins involved, and if you guys, how long it took you to get financing to actually go out and make this? Because it is bold, and apart from obviously a niche lesbian audience, which would be obvious for this as a gate, you know, you're not really sure, or at least I'm not sure, you know what I mean, how far you would go beyond that. So as far as from a financing perspective, you know, there's a certain risk obviously involved in investing in films, and if it's not a wider audience,
How long did it take you guys to get the financing? Because, you know, it's a pretty bold project, so.
I know you want more questions, so I'll quickly say Telefilm Canada and the UMDC were very excited by the bold content, love the script, and love the visual depictions of, like, what we were about to do, and the all-female crew.
And Serendipity Point Films arranged all financing for us, brought on Distant Horizon, push for us. And yeah, that's really what happened. We were very, very careful with what our budget was, so we had to stick to it. Obviously, we had to be very careful. And April, one of the things that was very great about April is she's produced all of her own films before this, so she really understood that budget level. And it's mine and Stephanie's first feature film, so April was able to sort of really help us by going through our budget and saying things that we needed, things we didn't need, and so we were able to, you know, stretch what we had very far. We also called in a lot of favors. At the end, you start, like, seeing the numbers going down. So that's when you start calling in a lot of favors, and we were able to do that, too. So, yeah.
What's a Merkin?
I don't know what a Merkin is either.
I had to Google it because some of the actresses, when we were pre-reading, were asking if they could wear one. and I saw a lot of colorful ones. It's like something you put on top.
Way.
Yeah.
Oh.
We said no. So no, we didn't have them.
No, no, I said oh.
Oh. Yeah.
Yes, I learn stuff every day.
We really just wanted everybody to be who they were and be natural, and you know, people ask some weird questions about grooming and if we knew or what we didn't know. It was just like, hey, show up and let's see what happens. I don't know. We didn't have any Merkins, no.
So sans Merkins. Oh yeah, the way you were there in the middle. Last question, and we have to wrap it up. So.
Okay.
Did you use an all-local crew? Because you obviously, the film has a very intimate knowledge of Toronto as well.
Yes, it was all local, and Stephanie loves and is a huge fan of the city, so you can talk about the script, because I just brought it to life.
This is the city I grew up in, this is the city I was about to be myself in, and it was important that we shoot here because I feel like the city was a character, a presence in the room.
We just wanted to
be able to
flat out.
Nice. Cool.
Yeah.
All right, I'm afraid I have to wrap it up.
Thank you so much.
Congratulations on the film. It's coming out right before Valentine's Day, February 10th, so please tell your friends.